Will the audience please rise? The audience may be seated. I'd like to welcome family and friends that are here to celebrate the life of Mark Perrett. Today, presiding will be President James Evans. I'm Bishop Michael Roberts, and I'll be conducting today. Our chorister will be Brooke McCarty, a granddaughter, and then Shannon Holland, who's from our ward, will be playing the piano. The opening hymn will be "I Feel My Savior's Love." The words can be found in the program. And then the opening prayer will be offered by Jonathan Wright, son-in-law.
Thank you. Our dear, kind Heavenly Father, we are grateful to be gathered together as family and friends of Mark Perrett. Please bless us that we may feel the joy and love and care that Mark has shown us throughout the years. We're grateful for those that have traveled far and to support this wonderful man. We're grateful for their love and support for coming. Holy Father, please bless us as we celebrate and remember Mark, that we will take his love that he has shown us and we may share that with others. And please help us to remember that our Savior has done so much for us. We are grateful for Mark and the life that he has shared with us. We're grateful for him. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for the plan of salvation, the plan of happiness that gives us understanding that we may live again and be with our families again. And we pray, Heavenly Father, and do so in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
The program will proceed with the following speakers. Jeff Isaacson's son, then we'll have Jackie Isaacson, daughter, and then we'll have a musical number, the grandkids and the great-grandkids singing, "I Love to See the Temple and Families Can Be Together Forever."
Good morning. I actually have two sets of thoughts that I'll be sharing today. Mark's beloved sister, Rana, is kept out in New York, Virginia. because of some COVID exposure. And so she has sent some thoughts that I'll be sharing. And the first of those is she and Mark were so very close to their cousins, and I wanted to just recognize them by name. So his cousins were Mort Rubenstein, this is not going great, and his wife Shirley, Harold Kohler and his wife Cookie, Irv Kohler, who has passed, Charlene Kohler, Eddie Kohler, survives his wife Karen, and Jerry Kohler is survived by his wife Norma, Fran Miller with her husband Clark, Harris Clear and his wife Betty, and then Mark and Rana. It was a small cousin group, but they were very close-knit. Rana goes on to say that, as in most families, Mark was an adored big brother who was followed by his annoying little sister. She followed him around and wanted to play with all of his toys. She says, "I still remember the day our mom told me I was no longer allowed to tag along with him and his friends. But I got even when we was teenagers and I started dating his friends. He had to let me tag along then. That's when our relationship transitioned to one of friends, not just siblings. His friends, my friends, became one large group, and many of my friends from that time still tell me of the crushes and the fond feelings they had for Mark. For those to whom Mark has not revealed his early self, he was a free-spirited, wanderlust, long-haired hippie. He loved to travel, and he did a lot of it by motorcycle. In fact, most people don't know that Mark actually lived in Europe for quite a while and traveled Europe and African continents by motorcycle. Rana's favorite stories about Mark are the times where he was traveling to Philadelphia in a terrible rainstorm, and he had stopped at his aunt and uncle's house in hopes of staying, albeit unannounced, in a nice warm bed for the night. He arrived looking bedraggled and his clothes sopping wet, and the aunt and uncle were about to dismiss him, thinking he was a vagabond, but he had to announce, "It's me, your nephew Mark." They had to look at him for a long second to believe him. Mark was a brilliant man with a quirky sense of humor. I can still hear his voice teasing me about wanting to leave some friend's early gathering. He'd sing, "Every party has a pooper, that's why we invited you." I hope I never lose the ability to hear that voice. I'm going to miss him. The second set of thoughts I have prepared are my own. You may have seen a t-shirt on display that says, "My favorite people call me Grandpa." As I was a favorite and most likely the favorite, I will be calling him Grandpa for my talk. Paul asked the Corinthians, "Oh death, where is thy sting?" The sting is here in my heart. It's here in this room. It's written in the Doctrine and Covenants that thou shalt live together in love, insomuch that thou shalt weep for the loss of them that die. Grandpa's death stings me, and it stings us because we loved him. The first time Grandpa fired me, I was a freshly returned missionary and was hired to babysit my little brother Mike. I made some bad decisions caring for him. I wasn't going to elaborate on him, but I will. I came in the middle of the night and took Mike with me on a road trip. Before we had cell phones. And I thought it unwise to leave a note or to notify them, so I didn't. Well, that night, Grandpa sat me down and told me I was fired. And he ended the conversation with, "I love you, bud." Recently, several of us had the opportunity to go on a road trip with Grandpa to Glacier National Park. It was so much fun. Grandpa and I sat around talking one evening about how great the trip was and about our favorite sights and how beautiful and grand the mountains there were. He ended that conversation with, "I love you, bud." My last conversation with Grandpa was in the hospital and was very, very short. He was so tired that he slept most of the time I was there. But as I was leaving, he lifted his oxygen mask. From his face so I could hear him and said, "Do you know I love you, bud?" I told him I did and that I loved him too. Grandpa loved me like I hope the Savior loves me. When I fail, I can hear his voice. "I still love you, bud." When I win, I hear, "I love you, bud." And when someone When someone I love so very much dies, I hear, "I'm so sorry. I love you, bud." I'm going to end my thoughts today saying to each of you here, so on behalf of Grandpa or Dad or Mark, do you know I love you? We know, Grandpa, we all know.
When Mark's obituary was being composed, we were adding things that Mark loved. And my daughter Elise piped in and she said, "Grandpa loved hugs." It's not very easy to read through tears. Truer words have never been spoken. Mark loved. Mark loved. Mark was never afraid of difficult conversations, but you always knew he loved you. When introducing me, he always said, "This is my daughter, Jackie." And he was always so proud to call me his. I never once left my mom or Mark's house without Mark giving me a deliberate hug and a kiss on the cheek, to which the first several years I cringed away from because that's how we do. And then I got used to it and leaned in. And the last time I saw Mark was when I left his house and he hugged me and kissed me on the cheek and said, "I love you." That is Mark.
We will now hear from Spencer Isaacson's son. After that, we will hear from Lindsay Wright, daughter. And then we will have a musical number. Jed Madsen, son-in-law, will be accompanied by Jamie Curl, and we'll be singing Father and Son by Cat Stevens, which I understand is one of his Mark's favorite songs and would do it in different church events. So we're excited to hear that.
Sorry. Oh, that's disgusting. I had to write everything down, and I kind of got carried away. But I'm going to read it all anyways, because you're held hostage here. But my story about Mark is similar to many of the others that you have heard and that you will hear and that you've been told and that you've experienced. But I was a teenager when Mark came into my world. You know, at first I was confused why my mom wanted to date this guy who was so different from anything that I'd ever known before. It's very different from any of our way of thinking, just was just a different guy. But my mom must have seen something in him that we didn't, and I wouldn't understand for years to come, but I learned to understand. So before I went on my mission, I'd known Mark for years. He was always very kind and very respectful to my mom and to me and my brothers and sisters. He loved us, and he tried to take the time to get to know us. I traveled to Princeton. I took my first plane ride ever and flew from Arizona to Princeton to visit my mom and Mark and my sisters in New Jersey when they were living there. And I don't remember how old I was, but it was a fun trip. While we were there, we took a train ride from New Jersey to Washington, D.C. to visit Washington, D.C. while they were there. And I made my mom wake me up when we got stopped in Delaware so I could wake up and say, "Hi, I'm in Delaware." I was quoting Wayne's World. And Mark laughed about that for years. I think he was laughing at me more than with me, because who does that? And it was just kind of funny. You know, Mike came around a little bit after that, and he was a special kid, and he still is a wonderful kid. But he changed Mark's world so much. I think with having Mike be a part of his family, he got to appreciate a little bit more what my mom had to go through in raising the rest of us. And you would think that, you know, oh, well, now he has his own child, and these other kids are separate, and they should be treated separately, but that wasn't the case. And if anything, it brought us closer together. Mark understood us more, and he tried harder to be as part of his family. After Mark and my mom and my sisters and Mike moved back to Arizona from New Jersey, we got to spend more time together. There was oftentimes I was working out by the Intel plant where Mark was working, and my mom would come pick me up for lunch, and Mike and Mark and my mom and I would go meet Mark, and we'd have a picnic for lunch somewhere. I don't remember anything hardly about those picnics other than we did it. And I had a good time, and I enjoyed doing it. After my mission, Mark hired me to help him take care of his farm that he bought in Oregon. And so 2 weeks after I landed, got home from Mexico, I was on the road. I was driving the Lincoln, helping drive the Lincoln with my mom and Mike and Mark. I don't know, he was driving some other vehicle. I don't know if it was a moving truck or what it was. I think it was, I don't know what it was. It was a different vehicle though. But we had these walkie-talkies that Mark insisted that we didn't follow good protocol when driving with these walkie-talkies. So when we would say something, we'd have to end with "over," and then at the end of the conversation, "over and out." And there was lots of times when Mark would pipe up on the walkie-talkie just with some information or something that we needed to know or some interesting tidbit that really didn't require a response. I wrote it down really well, so I need to read it. Let me go find it. So, in order to acknowledge the receipt of this information, I would often reply, "Oh, over," which would then cause my mom and I to burst out laughing at the absurdity of the reply. And this would spawn years of jokes that we would still reference today. "Oh, over." The home in Oregon was a beautiful and just as awesome as you could imagine. The 55 acres that accompanied it was a bit of a need of cleanup. We spent so much time just trying to figure out how to turn on the sprinklers. We just have the valve turned on, and whenever we saw a little bit of water trickle out of one of the sprinklers, we were like, "Quick, go turn on the pump so that they could get some more pressure." And so we turn on the pump until the water ran out, and then we shut the pump off so it wouldn't burn up. And then it took us far too long to figure out that there was another pump up at the top of the hill with a big pump that supplied the water to the rest of the farm's irrigation systems that sucked it out of the ditch. But in our defense, it was covered with blackberries 20 feet deep, feet thick and deep. I don't know what word I'm trying to say, but it wasn't coming out properly. But part of the yard when we got there was cut short and half dead, and part of it was 3 feet tall and just flourishing. And in order to start getting, in order to clean up the overgrown portions of the lawn, we started using a literal scythe. So I was out there with a scythe trying to cut the grass. But then we upgraded to an industrial weed eater after we figured out that we had no idea how to use a scythe properly. And we then jumped to a push lawnmower, and after I left, that's when Mark finally opted to get a very large lawn tractor / small, you know, farm tractor. It had a brush hog attachment that could go through and mow down all of the larger section of weeds, and I'll tell you what, it would have saved me a lot of labor if we'd have got that the first thing. But I did spend 2 summers out there working. I spent a summer with Trent out there working on that farm. And we meticulously cleared out all the blackberries off of one of the islands in the farm. And then on the next island, we just torched it, and it cleared it. And that one stayed good. Okay, I torched it. Because I thought, this is ridiculous, because we'd have to bundle these blackberries and then pull them through a canoe through the pond, out to the other side. It was whatever. That's not even part of my talk. I don't know what we're talking about. While I was still a student at BYU, Mark decided to come out of his first retirement and actually got a job working at BYU while I was there. He spent a few months there without my mom and Mike while they stayed behind to get the farm sold. My new little family, consisting of Marisol, John, and myself, loved having Mark over for dinner often. We probably served him mac and cheese way too often. But he was always very complimentary. He'd always say, "I can get it so creamy. I can never get it to taste this good." And we literally just followed directions on the box. That was it. Mark was always willing to help others when he could and when it was right. Marisol and I have moved many times, and he's helped out with that on numerous occasions. When we had our first big move, and I call it a big move because we moved from a house to a house with 3 children, Mark and my mom and Mike showed up with Mark's flatbed trailer just in case everything we had didn't fit in the pod that we needed to take and for any odds and ends that we'll need while we're trying to find a house. And then we should, in all honesty, we packed that pod so well that we should win some kind of a Tetris award. It was scraping. We had like bulged the top a little bit by how tight we packed that thing full of stuff. And then we loaded the excess stuff on his flatbed trailer and then drove to his house because we didn't actually have a destination home to go to. And he took us in with a brand new with 3 kids this time, and a brand new newborn, Emma. And then when we moved from Utah to Texas, Mark helped us load up our truck and then took my family with five kids now, with a brand newborn Jake, into his home to stay over the night before we drove to Texas. Fortunately, Mark had to take me to the emergency room that night because I had some severe abdominal pain. Ended up having to get my gallbladder out the next day. And then he understood that we had a timetable, and I had a job at the start. I couldn't sit around waiting to recover before I left and drove off. So he volunteered to drive our moving truck that we loaded up to Texas for us. And so he spent the next 3 days driving to our place in Texas, and just to have to unload the truck when he got there because I couldn't lift anything more than 25 pounds or like a gallon of milk. And so he had to help us unload there. And he had to deal with my father-in-law. So he drove to Taos and then had loaded up Leroy in the truck with him. And I think they had a great time. Mark always remembered it fondly. He never spoke a word of ill about it. And I'm sure Leroy remembers it fondly as well. When we moved back home from Texas, he let us stay at his house again while we looked for a place to live, this time with another newborn, Judah. And we literally didn't have a penny because we took all of our change jar and cashed in so that we could pay for fuel. But he helped us out financially until I got my next paycheck and until our house sold. And we had a lot of money in our house, but not in assets, so we could pay that back pretty easily. But we always felt welcome in his home, even when we stopped by unannounced and by surprise. It was, "Oh, hey, Spence, how are you doing?" And if you aren't familiar with us, Isaacsons in general, but my family and specifically, we're loud, we're boisterous, and Mark loved to spectate on the sidelines. He was never an instigator. Well, I shouldn't say never. He was seldom an instigator in the boisterous activities, but he loved to spectate. And during this last week, we were going through a lot of the family pictures that we have of Mark, and so I was looking at them, and most of them that I have, we're doing something obnoxious in the foreground, and Mark is in the background just smiling away, just happy as can be about whatever was going on. And he enjoyed having his family around. He loved us. And the last conversation I had with him, I walked into the hospital room, and I woke him up and said, "Hi, Mark." He goes, "Hi, Spence. I love you." And so he told us that he loved us often. And I'm so glad that I had that conversation. If I'd have known that was the last one, I probably would have bugged him more. But, so last year, Mark planned a special fishing day with Jake, my son. And he spent months planning this fishing day, honestly. He showed up on the day that the fishing trip was going to happen. And showed up in his Corvette, and he had everything planned out. He had packed snacks and sandwiches, and everything was ready to go just to have a great day. And Jake still remembers it super fondly, and he caught the biggest fish that he's ever caught with Grandpa. I mean, it had to be this big. Way bigger than any fish that he's ever caught with. It might have been bigger than that. When Marisol told Judah, my youngest, that Grandpa had passed away, Judah was the first one awake, and Judah cried, and he was sad. But when Jake got up and Marisol told him that he had passed away, Jake bawled hard. And after composing himself for a minute, he called Judah over and gave him the biggest hug. And he said, "I'm so sorry that you don't get to go on a fishing trip like I did with Grandpa. It meant so much to him. I'm like my brothers, brothers-in-law. I'm so glad that I got to spend some time with him this summer, driving around Glacier National Park. It was an amazing experience. Honestly, it was. I'm so glad that he planned the trip and invited us all to go with him. Mark's faith in God will always inspire me. His dedication, his initiative, and his faith is always a good example for us. His effort to inspire, to make an eternal family, will be rewarded. I know he's so excited to find his parents in heaven now, to have a good talk with them. He is one of our Savior's chosen servants and will continue his work on in the next life. I just want to tell Mark, you're a wonderful man and father. I'm so glad that I got to know you in this life and look forward to our reminiscences in the next life. Over and out.
Part of me doesn't want this to end. Just so I can stay close to Mark. Okay. If you haven't gathered already, Mark is one cool guy. He came into my life when I was 13 years old, and Wes is art. He probably wasn't sure how to handle a teenage girl who wore her emotions on her sleeve. Evidence. But we figured it out through the years. I'm grateful for his consistent patience with me and for the many life lessons Mark taught me. He was always so proud to call us his own and to introduce us as my daughter and my son, and we're so proud to call him ours. As I sat there, I just felt like I really needed to share that our oldest brother, Trent, has a tender heart and loves Mark so much. My heart is filled with gratitude for the lessons he taught me. He introduced me to the exotic things in life, like fine cheeses, lox and bagels, which I, when I first saw it, was very puzzled as to why someone's eating a piece of raw fish. Paul Simon and the Beatles. He did the same thing for my daughter, Eliza. He taught her how to make an amazing tomato, cheese, and mayo sandwich on toasted bread. Mark introduced me to amazing places in the world like Niagara Falls, the Sacred Grove, the Statue of Liberty, and Central Park. I remember fondly the trip we took to upstate New York, where we spent time with his amazing sister, Rana, her husband, Rick, and their two darling daughters, Stacy and Erin. Mark and my mom are always so generous with their time and their resources. A few years ago, they purchased a cruise for all of us and them to go on together, and we had such a blast doing that. In January 2020, my brother Mike and sister Brooke ran in the Walt Disney World Marathon, and Mark and my mom were so supportive and were waiting there at the finish line for us as we crossed, even during record-breaking heat. And for those of you who know our sweet Mark, bless his heart, he was sweating through his shirt, but he was there with a smile and a Gatorade and just so cheerful. He taught me about the value of hard work and saving money. He was so generous and would pay for half of any big purchase, so that's how I was able to purchase my first car, an awesome Honda Civic. He patiently taught me to have confidence in myself, even through tears, as we sat at a table into the wee hours of the morning, as he tutored me with the dreaded Algebra 2. He lovingly did the same thing during COVID when my then 14-year-old son Ammon was being homeschooled. Ammon and Grandpa would spend hours together each day over Zoom. And I would hear their little conversations. What did you eat, Grandpa? And what are you doing today? And he'd say, M&M, when they'd get on. Ammon said yesterday, Grandpa's so Christ-like. He's full of love and compassion and asks us to do things that he knows will help us. Mark was 100%er. He was all in with his schooling, all in with his traveling and experiencing the world. And then he was all in loving our family. Mark was very supportive of my mom whenever she would drop everything to go and help us so many times. He came along and helped our family with countless house projects. He even used his amazing engineering skills and eye for detail to figure out a plan for us for a new closet that we built. Mark loved having fun and had a quick wit and contagious laugh. He did an amazing imitation of Donald Duck that could put a spell on any fussy baby or toddler. He had amazing nicknames for many of the grandkids and had a knack for helping each one feel special, loved, and wanted. This last year, I struggled with some health issues, so Eliza and I stayed with my mom and Mark for 10 weeks. I'm so grateful for that special time. I got to see him going about quietly serving others. There was a little boy in their ward that would drive by his bike on by their house and check out his awesome Corvette in hopes that maybe he would show it to him one day. Well, his mom called my mom and asked if there's any way for his birthday if he could have a ride in that Corvette. So Mark woke up early, and if you know Mark, he's a night owl, not a morning bird. But he woke up early and he took that little boy on a ride and then to school. And that's Mark. He was full of genuine compliments and faith-filled encouragement. He was a fierce protector and defender. He spoke the truth, even if it wasn't the most delicate of ways sometimes. My husband also loved Mark. They bonded during an annual fishing trip they went on with my husband's family. He was such a blessing in both of their lives. And when Mark passed away, Jonathan said, I miss my friend. Jonathan said the other day he was laying down and thinking about Mark and thinking about what happens when we die here. And he said, it seems a lot like what would happen when a missionary comes home. That there's kind of just this entrance of people coming in and there's big groups and saying, it's Mark, it's Mark. And I think that's probably right. Like Jackie said, Mark gave the best hugs, and I miss the hugs already. Many times in my life, Mark lovingly counseled me to not be afraid and to trust the Lord in his plan. I know he must have had moments of fear and anxiety toward the end. But I know that Mark trusted the Lord in his plan. My son Micah was on a mission during most of COVID, so didn't get to share as much treasure time with Grandpa as much as the other kids, but I know Grandpa was so glad that Micah was helping others to feel the Savior's love for them because he was so grateful that he found that love. When Mark was in the hospital, I think he had just been intubated, and I called my mom, and we live in Arizona, so we didn't get to go see him in person, but I said, you know, can I just talk to him? Will you just hold up the phone to his ear? And I just told him, thank you so much for everything, and she said that he got this little furrow in his brow when I started talking. that he would get a lot of times when he was thinking about something. So I hope that I know that he here knows that. I'm so grateful for Mark and the life that he led, and I'm grateful for the love he showed and the lessons he taught me. And I so look forward to the time when we will make more memories together. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Times that I cry, even all the things I knew inside, well, it's hard, but it's harder to ignore it. If they were right, I'd agree, but it's them they know, not me. Now there's a way, and I know that I have to go.
We will now hear from Brooke Mattson, daughter. And after Brooke, we'll hear from Mike Perrette, son. And then there will be a family men's choir, which will sing How Great Thou Art. And then Judy Perrette will be the concluding speaker.
When I suggested we do oldest to youngest, and I was going to go after Jed, I probably should have rethunk that. It's hard for me to express in words how much I loved Mark and how much I'm going to miss him. So I thought I'd share a few of my fondest memories. And I'm going to read off this paper because I don't know if I can make it through this otherwise. It must have been extremely hard for him to find love, get married, and have an instant family with six kids and a seventh soon to join the party. I can't even imagine it, especially having a couple teenage girls going through puberty with raging hormones and crazy emotions, but he never skipped a beat. He embraced me fully into his life, even when I'm sure that I didn't always make it easy on him. After he married my mom, life with Mark was really exciting for me. He took us places I had only dreamed about. We went to New York City when we went to visit his awesome sister, Rana, and her family. We took a train all the way down to Washington, D.C., like Spencer told you, when I was 11, and I felt like I was in a movie because it was just so different for me. We got to go to Disney World when we flew to see his dad in Florida, and everything felt so magical. It felt like the whole world had opened up to me. Something that changed quite dramatically after they got married was our adventures in fine dining. It felt like we got to go out to eat all the time, which was way more than I was used to. This was a new experience for me, and I relished it. The waiter would come, and no exaggeration, I would look at the menu and say, for my appetizer, I'll have this. For my entree, I'll have this. And for my dessert, I'll have this. And are there free refills? Because I already drank my Sprite. I don't think I ever once finished that food. But instead of yelling at me for wasting money or food, he just laughed. He was so patient with me. He just let me order it, and we'd just box up the leftovers and take them home. Eventually, I stopped doing that, which I'm sure made him happy. When I got to college, it was time for me to buy a car. I was working hard, and I knew I could make the payments, so my mom and Mark took me out to pick one. Mark helped me find one that was reliable and safe, and I was so happy and so proud. Mark was my bank. He paid for it, and I made the monthly payments to him. But I was a dumb kid, and I made a big mistake. I got the cheapest insurance that I could find, and I had no extra coverage at all. Only a couple months later, I was driving up to Salt Lake with one of my roommates, and I hit black ice on the freeway. My car started spinning, and I hit the median, and I got out and I looked at the car and I was really relieved because it didn't look like it was hurt at all. There was just a small dent, but it was in the back corner. And so when I got in it to drive away, I could tell that something was majorly wrong. Long story short, I hit the median in exactly the wrong place on my car and it knocked the entire car frame out of alignment. So my new car was totaled. This is when I learned that the insurance I had only covered accidents with other cars and only their cars. So I got nothing from insurance. I sold the car for scrap and I gave that money to Mark, but I still owed more money. So I kept making payments on the car. But a few months after that, I graduated from BYU when my mom and Mark came to Utah for my graduation. Mark gave me a box that had some papers in it, and he was so excited. The first page said, "Your car loan." The next page had the total that I still owed, which was just under $7,000. And then at the bottom it said, "Now you see it." And then I flipped the page, and the last page said, "Now you don't. Happy graduation." That was Mark. He was funny. He just loved making fun jokes, but he was so excited to give me that box. Obviously, I was thrilled, but I think he was even happier than I was because Seeing my joy made him so happy. And I'm sure as many of you know, he was extremely generous in giving. During the terribleness that was 2020, my son Truman was trying to find something to occupy his time that summer. He really wanted to make a display case for his Lego minifigures, so he asked Grandpa to help him. Mark said, "I would love to help you, but we're gonna do this right, and we are going all the way with this, no quitting." So Truman might have been fine just grabbing a few pieces of wood and screwing them together and calling it good, but not Mark. They measured the minifigures, drew schematics, which you can see over there, planned exactly the right amount of wood to buy, sanded it, stained it. He did everything. Mark taught him how to use a table saw and a drill. But I think one of the best things that he taught Truman was the importance of exactness. Because with woodworking, if your measurements are off even just a little bit, your project won't turn out right. And that's how Mark lived his life, with exactness. We have an advent calendar in our hall that we put up at Christmas time at my house. And it's a Christmas tree with little felt ornaments that you put up every day that have a name of Christ on them and a scripture to go with it. And a few days ago, one of them caught my eye, Advocate. Every Sunday, we take the sacrament at church and promise that we are willing to take upon us the name of Christ. When I saw Advocate, one of the names of Christ, it made me think of Mark. That is one attribute, one name of Christ that he completely took upon himself. When I was in the darkest, hardest time of my life, I knew without a doubt that my mom and Mark were on my side. They were my advocates, always my advocate. When I made that mistake with my car, he was there. He was there to pay the rest of that debt for me. He was willing and able to take that upon himself. He was such an example of Christ-like love. The last words he said to me were, "How are you feeling? Are you hurting?" Even as he lay in the hospital, he was worried about me. We got him a shirt for Father's Day a couple years ago that said, "If Grandpa can't fix it, no one can." He loved that shirt. He was very proud of it. He wore it a lot. And he was always there to help me fix whatever needed fixing. Whether it be my treasured Christmas decorations that sometimes broke from the snow, a broken light fixture that actually turned out to not be broken, just needed to screw it in, or a broken heart that really was broken. When you feel like you have no way out of the mess that you've made for yourself, when you feel like you're drowning in grief and sorrow, there's nothing more comforting than knowing you have someone on your side, no matter what. Someone there to speak up for you when you feel like you have no voice. That was Mark. Mark was protective and loving. And I don't see why that would change right now just because we can't see him. He's still there, watching over us, being our champion on the other side, always our advocate. He will always be there holding our hands when times get hard, saying, "I would love to help you, but we're going to do this right, and we're going all the way with this." In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
So there are so many stories I was thinking that I could share, but it was pretty easy for me to choose, I think, one of the most recent and dear to my heart, and it sounds, you know, kind of dumb, but last year when we all got sent home from work to just quarantine at home and work from home, I was not able to do so at my house because my internet service is not good at all at my house. So instead, I just went to Mom and Dad's house to hang out and bless my parents' very patient hearts, both of them. They're both very clean and orderly people, as you can see by the pegboard display here. That is a miniature of how Dad kept his garage, everything in its place. So I came along and set up a semi-permanent, not permanent, internet cord, just kind of like stringing down the hall and just took over one of the rooms. I'm sure that it was very trying for both of them, but they never said anything negative about it. But during that time, my dad and I got to experience VR gaming together for the first time, which was very exciting for both of us because we're both just, you know, tech nerds. And there was one game in particular we discovered that we really liked that had just come out called Half-Life Alyx, and it's exactly the sort of thing that that he loves, you know, a sci-fi game, sci-fi adventure game. And, you know, so we both were really excited and loved playing it. The catch, though, is that when it comes to virtual reality gaming, it's not something you can easily do together. It's pretty much a one-person thing. And so it would just end up that one of us would play and the other would just kind of watch the screen while the other person was playing. And because I'm the very patient human being that I am, usually I did not watch him play. I did not have the patience, but he did. Every time that I played, he just was so contented to just sit and watch. And, you know, this would happen for hours at a time. Like, you know, we'd play for like 3 or 4 hours and he would just sit and watch and was just perfectly happy doing that. And personally, I just thought that was kind of silly. And I was like, oh, it's fine. He's just like napping or whatever. But now looking back at it afterwards, I realize that's kind of not the point at all. He just liked spending time. And that's, you know, just looking back at so many different experiences and not just my own, but it really didn't matter what you were doing or where you were. He just loved being with you. And I always felt like he just, it didn't matter. Like I could just come up with the most ridiculous, stupid project idea. And he'd be like, yeah, okay, let's do it. Just because he wanted to spend time. And I know that wasn't just for me either. Every person that he spent time with, like you felt like he wanted to do that. And that was just so fun. Like even if it was doing something stupid, like sitting on a couch and watching you play a game that he doesn't get to participate in, he enjoyed that. But just, you know, like all my siblings have said, that was just one of the many ways that he expressed love. And that's something that I hope to learn and take with me from him, is just the free giving of love on such an individual basis. You know, he possessed many Christ-like attributes, but I think that's one of my very favorite, that every person was deserving of individual love and care, and he gave it in a very selfless way that cost him a lot of time and patience. But anyway, that's something that I hope to develop and I'm very grateful for.
I am the most blessed and filled with joy person right now. That song, when Mark and I first started dating, one Saturday he said, "Do you want to go on a motorcycle ride tomorrow?" And I said, "I don't do that on Sunday. I go to church." And he said, "Oh, well, can I come with you?" And this is my Jewish boy that was knew there was a supreme being, but didn't know quite what. And I said, "Of course." I don't think he missed from that time until we tested positive for COVID more than a handful of meetings. He was just there, all in, as the kids have said. But that song, "How Great Thou Art," was sung during one of the meetings after he'd been coming for a while. And he would reach over when we'd be listening in church and something particularly profound and deep doctrine and truth was taught. He would reach over and grab my hand and look at me and say, "I love you." And it finally dawned on me, he's feeling the Holy Ghost. That just bore witness to his soul that what he just heard is true. Well, when he heard that song, that was just it. It just sang and spoke to him. And I can guarantee that, well, I can't guarantee it. The state president sitting right there, and he might be able to say, "I don't know if you know that." My sense is that Mark was up there with those beautiful boys singing his heart out. Coincidentally, I'm just looking at Philip. Philip's dad passed away, our beloved brother-in-law, 3 years ago on New Year's morning, and that was his dad's, Carl. That was his favorite song too, Kindred Spirits. I want to share just a few thoughts about Mark, and I like Brooke, I'm gonna read word for word, and you know, whoever else, Spence. He was, well, he still is. A remarkable man. I love him and I miss him. I miss talking to him. I was in the same room with him for hours and hours and hours and hours the last 2 weeks, and I didn't get to talk to him. And so I would say, Mark, especially when he was intubated and in a medically induced coma, Mark, I'm going to go ahead and talk with you just like I'm pretty sure you can hear me. And I would visit, and he wouldn't answer. And I missed that. I will miss talking to him. Over the years, he would tell a story or mention a place that I would have never heard him talk about before. And when I voiced surprise or asked him what he was talking about, he would say something like, "Oh, that was when I was in Africa working on the first weather satellite with NASA." As nonchalantly as if he had said, "Oh, I just ran down to 7-Eleven and grabbed a big gulp." It was interesting and intriguing to see what new nugget of information I would learn as we went along. The first time I saw Mark, he was rushing into a staff meeting that had already started at Intel. His walk made it clear he was a man on a mission. Not exactly stomping, not exactly fuming, but he had a message and it was going to be heard. The group that Mark was managing at that time was working on the design of the Pentium processor, I believe, and had not been getting adequate time on the computers needed for certain tasks. And let me just insert quickly that I don't have a clue what I'm talking about now. I was not in that room as an electrical engineer. But he's probably listening and laughing right now and maybe cringing because of the way I'm talking about something that I don't know anything I'm talking about. But anyway, suffice it to say, he was a little ticked off and wasn't backing down on what his group required. He spoke with directness and passion and determination to get for his group what they needed to be successful. I knew then and there that that was a man worth getting to know. After the meeting ended, he stopped and introduced himself and then hurried out. So what did I learn about Mark Porrette that day, that first encounter? He is a man of loyalty and passion and could get to the point, mincing no words. That's how my life with Mark began. First business acquaintances, then friends, then came love, then came marriage. It was a bit of a wild ride, but worth it. Mark and I worked hard on becoming a good couple, a strong and devoted couple, and in trying to provide love and safety and protection for the kids. He was a remarkable provider. He loved to be included in all of the craziness and was eager to jump in and be a great mentor and champion for all of us. Mark didn't have any children, so when he opened his arms to me and my six, well, as I stated, and you can imagine, it was a wild ride. But what an incredible human being to jump in and go for it as he did with every single thing he undertook to do. Have I mentioned how much I miss him? In the obituary that the kids wrote, you read that Mark had so many amazing adventures with his career, his travel, his hobbies, but we didn't mention how much he loved snorkeling and scuba diving. And it's a good thing he had someone else to go in the water with, because I am a landlubber through and through. So when Mark and I would go to some island location, he would dive and I would sit on the beach to make sure everything was going smoothly there. But before he would get on the boat, he would say something like this: "Hey Jude, see if you can find another couple to have dinner with tonight." And I would look at him like, "Did you just go around the bend? Did you forget who I am? I am a top-notch, outgoing introvert." But but invariably, he had found another couple to dine with before the day ended. So what did I learn from Mark early on in our marriage? What did I learn about him? That he was gregarious and generous and adventurous, a risk taker, and loved to make new friends. After Mark joined the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, he was again all in. He loved everything about all the callings that he held. And he loved everything about the people with whom he served. But he grew to love the temple of the Lord in a way I have never seen before. He served as a temple worker for over 20 years in Mesa, Arizona, in Central Point, Oregon, and in Provo, Utah. But when he and I would go to do an endowment session, it would seem like I was the only woman in the waiting area where people wait for each other to come out of the dressing room after the session. He had always found someone he knew in that dressing room and would get so engrossed in a conversation that I soon learned to just settle in and read the scriptures or just enjoy the serenity of the temple, because it was going to be a while. The first time that we went to a temple that was out of state, I thought, well, I won't be sitting here for a half an hour waiting for Mark. We don't know anyone. Oh, foolish girl. Mark would come striding out looking like he had just hit pay dirt, because he had. He had found and made a new friend. There are so many stories that I could tell that would speak to the depth of the heart and the soul of the man who brought comfort, security, life, and love into my life and the lives of my six children. And then the added joy of having a seventh child with him. As the kids have given stories and snapshots and examples of life with Mark, and you've heard some experiences from me, you can take those experiences and extrapolate to what every facet of our lives, what it was like, what it's been like with him. I had never been acquainted with someone who opened their arms wide open to bring in a single mom and six children under his protective care, like Mark did for us. And the joy that he had when Mike was born and joined our family. I have never seen anyone embrace and immerse themselves in a love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the love for his beloved Son, Jesus Christ, like Mark did. Another thing that I hadn't seen before is one of my loved ones slip through the veil as quickly and quietly as Mark did. When the fight with COVID had come to an end. And I've never been filled with such longing and excitement to see someone again as I am now at the thought, and with the promise of eternity spent with my husband, my friend, the sweet father of the children, my Mark. A poem by Robert O. Beatty sums up what I want to say. If on this night of still white cold, I can remember May, new green of trees and underbrush, the scent of earth and noon's blue hush. If on this night of bitter frost I know such things can be, I shall believe the tales men tell of Columbine an infidel, asphodel, not infidel, of Columbine, an asphodel, and immortality. I know God lives. I know Jesus Christ, his Son, rose from the grave to become the first fruits of them that slept. And because of that, I know that all of us will see Mark again in a most joyful reunion. I bear this testimony to you in the sacred and holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
It's been a wonderful morning to hear about Mark. I had an opportunity to work with him as part of my ward council for about 7 years, and I will miss him. I was looking forward. He was just called to be my ward clerk. We just started talking, and he had all kinds of great ideas, as you would expect, and I do miss him, but he has left a legacy of love and service and to both his family and his friends. President Evans is going to have some just concluding comments. Afterwards, we will sing Love One Another, and the closing prayer will be offered by Marisol Isaacson, daughter-in-law. And also, after the service, there is a family luncheon at the Heatherridge Steak Center, which is on 450 East, 2000 North.
This has been awfully amazing today. You know, a lot's been said about Mark, but you two were together, and I've never known Mark without knowing Judy. And their love to me, to any, there's never been a time when I have not interacted with them in the parking lot at church, the hallway in a chapel, somewhere in an interview, where I just felt love, and I felt better after seeing them. I reminded her, I even felt love from her one time. She told me, and under no certain terms, I could call her anything, but don't call her to be a young women camp leader and expect her to camp, because she did not camp. I've never forgotten that. And but I felt such love afterwards that I thought that would have been okay. That would have been all right. So there's just two things I want to share today. I know the time's long, but as your stake president, Heavenly Father's want me to share this, and if I can do this. And this is mainly a quote. You wonder sometimes, why do people get called home early? Why do we have to die? You could say it was COVID, but there's also people that make it past COVID, to make it through. Why was it his turn? And I love this quote. I feel it's important for the grandchildren and children today, and for you to know this. This is by Elder Neil A. Maxwell, a former apostle of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and he said this: mortal life may need to be shortened, but if so, it may be done in order for special services to be rendered by that individual in the spirit world, services that will benefit thousands of new neighbors. He went on to say this: on the other side of the veil, there are perhaps billions and billions of people who need the same gospel, and releases occur here to aid the work over there. Each release of a righteous individual, which Mark was, from this life is also a call to new labors. Those who have had, so Bishop, the Lord needed him more than you need him for ward clerk, okay? Elder Axel. Those who have true hope understand this. Therefore, though we miss the departed righteous person much here, hundreds may feel their touch there. One day, and this is the promise I give to you that Elder Max talked about, one day, hundreds and hundreds of people will thank the bereaved for the gracefully foregoing of the expended time with them. So bottom line is, I just add my testimony that one day, there's hundreds and hundreds of people that will thank you, Mark's family here today, for allowing him to go early to start that work that God needed him to do over there. And the other thing I want to tell your grandchildren is this, is we wonder, you know, the spirit world, where is it? Where is Mark? And you talked about him being here. He's here today. I felt the spirit as your stake president. I testify that. So you weren't speaking any false truths. But this is what Brigham Young said about the spirit, where he went over the spirit world. He said, where is the spirit world? It is right here. Do the good, yes, they're right here, and they want to say this. Where is the spirit world? It's right here. Suppose the Lord would touch your eyes that you might now see the other spirits. You would see them plainly as we see one another. I testify of that. And the one thing that I want to promise to you and your children is this. As you and your family find yourself in the temple, you'll be given opportunities to literally be ministered to by Mark in the temple. I testify of that. That's a blessing I give you as you go to the temple. Number two, as you grandchildren follow promptings as you pray, and Heavenly Father says you need to go bless this person or say hi or kind. As you're kind to other people, there's times throughout your mortal life when Heavenly Father will allow your grandfather to be with you, to serve with you as you serve other people. I leave that promised blessing with you from Heavenly Father in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our dear Father in heaven, we are so grateful for this beautiful day, for the opportunity that we have to celebrate Mark and for the life that he lived and for the legacy that he left for all of us. We ask you to please help us to continue to feel thy peace and thy love and guidance. And we ask you to bless us and those who are traveling, that they'll be safe. And these things we humbly pray for and ask in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would the audience please stand? That's the conclusion of this service. Thank you for coming.